something with Alistair, with Shen or Ezra, though, by banning Alistair, there's two other really high-profile picks left, and that's Shen and Ezra. We see if SK wants to leave one on the table or just ban one and give the team the other. This is actually a very important ban here. I don't know if they're quite expecting this.
And the one final Sona ban going out. Is this ban targeted, or are we going to see this coming in so they have to pressure a different pick?
I think they're playing the pick game right now because you know, blue team right now gets one pick, but then the purple team gets two. Yet that Shen's going to come out. It's going to be Ezreal and probably their second favorite support. Niff's been playing Janna a lot. He loved that champion all throughout that regional. Like 80% of his games are, you know, with Janna there. That's a pretty likely pick here, unless they've decided, you know what, the support wins have changed. We've got something else going on. I would honestly expect Ezreal here. Otherwise, this doesn't make a lot of sense. If they weren't going to try to deny Ezreal from Kid, who was doing amazing with that champion so far. Oh, I'm completely wrong on both counts. They're actually going to rush that top lane out with Jace and grab Nunu as a jungler or maybe a support.
Yes, they are going to do that very nicely, Jace. For that top lane, you said new support and whatnot. This is kind of pokey for them if they continue the comp we're thinking of. How is that going to work out against Kid's Ezreal and that top? We're going to have a PDD's at Aurelia.
Yeah, it looks like Aurelia right now. And actually, now that they grabbed that Nunu, I get it. If it's support Nunu, the one bad matchup that Nunu really has there is against Sona. The Ice Blast Harass just gets healed over and you can ignore it. You know, the long range poke that comes from Sona, Nunu doesn't have any recourse for that. He can't heal his teammate up. It makes a really risky situation. I actually like, though, SK's bottom lane, the potential for the bottom lane here, because they've got Nunu, who wants to just kind of fight. He's going to Blood Boil a teammate, Ice Blast the opposition, and they're just going to get into battles. And it's not going to be very hard for SK to win a straight up fight. Invictus, they just picked up Leona, which is an all-in. She's going to dive in, stun up a champion, try to go for a fight, a hardcore fight, and follow up with Ezreal. But I think as far as just kind of fighting a two-on-two, a little tango, I think Nunu outperforms Leona there. So as long as they pick a good, you know, high fight potential AD carry to team up here in this bottom lane, I like SK's bottom lane chances. Now, we know that they've got Jace there. The thought here on Aurelia is weird because I think they already have their top laner. Corki is a really, really good pick here. That's exactly what they need. That Corki, okay, they're just doing all kinds of, I'm just going to stop talking about potential picks here. But they've got a very heavy all-in here from Invictus. They've got a lot of diving combos, and now this composition makes a lot more sense. They're going to put Udyr into the jungle, Nunu on support, Jace up at the top lane, and that Nunu Corki bottom lane, I think, is going to have a really, really good time against Leona Ezreal. I like SK's bottom lane right now.
It's going to be very good. I like the combination of accelerating Udyr to start these ganks and giving him a little bit more speed. We have the Cassiopeia once again. Usually, she has not been seen a lot in competitive play. It was said that she's kind of easy to counter, but with the right composition, it's exactly what she does the best, reinitiating the fights when the team is staring right at you and you can go back into it. They also have an unstoppable force with Malphite to do that as well.
This is looking like a very, very good team from Invictus. They've got a lot of diving potential. And again, when you look back at Nunu being the support there, it's not a defensive support, it's an offensive support. It's like when you grab Leona there, you're there to start a fight and deal a lot of damage. And your carry is gonna be kind of like on his own and be like, hope you don't die, bro, I'm gonna go kill people, peace. And that's a little bit risky for Yellow Star. And so what Invictus have done when they have Leona and Shen and Malphite is a lot like their first team comp with Jarvan, Nocturne, and Leona. Corki's going to get dunked on a whole lot here. With those lock-ins in place, they can send three people in to dunk on Corki, and his life's going to be miserable. And back on that front line, they've got Shen to stand united back on a teammate, Cassiopeia the counter initiation with Petrifying Gaze, and then Ezreal just so kitey in general, it's going to be hard for Kid. It's going to be hard for Kid to really die here unless SK pulls out some kind of crazy dive composition. So now they've locked in their final pick here on Karthus.
Wow.
It's a very big change of pace for Ocelot. Now we did see, of course, that Karthus the very first time around when they played against Azubu Frost, didn't quite work out for him, but it seems that Ocelot finally wants to play Karthus again instead of being that permanent ban. So adding that champion to his roster does help them in champion select overall, but the difficulty here now is how are these team comps going to work? There's a giant dive composition now here that can shut down Yellow Star's Corki, and that could be very, very scary for him because he doesn't have support there. He's got offense, all offense on that team. And if they start out a 5-on-4 and then Shen can reset and stand united a friend, you've got a very bad situation.
You know, Freak, Ocelot coming in, playing a lot of Karthus lately, usually the number one banned champion for SK Gaming. I really saw an Orianna for that team. You have Blood Boil, you have Acceleration Gate, you will be able to shield Corki. As you said, the other team is just going to jump on him and dunk him over and over again. And yep. You can utilize all of those to really put yourself on the top or shield somebody. With Karthus, do you think Orianna would have been the better pick?
Well, they couldn't have grabbed her. That was actually the very first ban from Invictus. This was actually them
good thing
from
I'm paying
Champions
attention.
League. Yeah, exactly.
It's a good
worry.
Thing. I'm
it's
here.
Okay.
We're here. Yeah. We're here.
Your whole weekend, right? So that was really, I think, Invictus all knowing
right.
the strategy
so
from day one, where, you know, just like the very first game, which I think they could have had against Frost and come out, you know,
right.
really, really strong there, is they knew they wanted to go really dive heavy. By first picking Shen, they denied that global shield. By banning out Orianna, they denied, you know, a lot of that safe, you know, protect the X, you know, champion there. So, and honestly, with Vladimir banned out, they're not going to run double AP. It's like, sure, let's go a bunch of bruisers. Let's dive onto enemy champions. And I think anytime you put Leona in the mix, I think that's the right way to play it, because she can initiate the fight, and as long as you get two more dive champions on that roster, you're going to start fights, and someone's going to drop out really, really fast. SK actually choosing that Nunu grab for an offensive support does leave Yellow Star available to some very rough situations. Now, maybe he can channel his inner Captain Jack. I don't know if you guys saw that video, but he breaks like five ultimates by, he spell shields Malphite ultimate as Sivir, flashes Morgana ultimate, Quicksilver sashes, I forget what the next, it might have been like Leona or something like that, and then cleanses another one and just like gets out from an entire initiation combo. Now, being Corki, he's got Valkyrie. I don't think he's bringing Cleanse into the game, but he might bring something like a Banshee's Veil or a Quicksilver Sash, so he might be able to withstand some of the aggression that was coming out, but it's going to be very hard for him to dodge Malphite's Unstoppable Force, and the rest of that combo that follows up is going to be risky as well. But even if Yellow Star does die, they might still have what it takes. They've got double Bruiser here with Udyr and Jace putting out a lot of damage on the front line. They've got Ocelot on Karthus, where if you spend your initial burst trying to kill Corki, then you have not spent any time trying to kill Karthus, and he's going to wreak havoc throughout your team. They've got an exhaust there. They're going to have one on Nif, on Nunu, and they're going to have one on Ocelot on Karthus. So if they can land two exhausts in a row onto Kid's Ezreal, he won't be putting out any damage. Illusion would have burned all of his cooldowns. Xiaoxiao's not going to be putting out a lot of damage once he's already used Solar Flare to try to combo out Corki. So you might see these fights kind of turn like we saw really with Frost versus Invictus, where they kill one champion, but then someone else carries it through. You might see that repeat again because you've got a lot of hyper carries available to SK.
So, Freak, with a matchup like Yellow Star's Corki, also a favorite on Ezreal, but that Kid's Ezreal, they're going to be having that. How do you see this one going with that Leona and that Nunu?
Overall, I think it's going to go really, really well. As far as the laning goes for SK, I think it's overall a better lane for SK Gaming. And, you know, we'll see how that plays out. Of course, skill factors in much more than anything else, but both these teams have run very disruptive junglers. Udyr on one side, actually Malphite on the other, so they're going to come in, be able to land a bit of crowd control, and contribute quite a bit of damage. So you know, it's going to depend really, can Ara outperform Illusion or vice versa? That's going to mean a lot in this lane, because both of these supports come in with a wealth of crowd control, whether it's Leona with a Solar Flare or Pre-6 just simply the dash in and the Shield of Daybreak for the stun, or is it going to be just all about Nif's Ice Blast? That can be enough lockup for Udyr to finally follow in. It's going to be very, very close overall, and there's going to be just some very close factors. There's no guarantees either way.
So, Freak, for those of people just tuning in, just getting to us, Rivington III and Freak here at LA Live, tell them about what we're looking at. SK can force the tie, or they're going to be going home.
So we're here in the sixth game of the group stage. We've got another group in front of you guys. If you've been just tuning in, we're only halfway through today's festivities, and only a third of the way, as far as days are concerned, throughout this tournament. So we've got so much more in store for you guys. We are seconds away from this game starting. Group A about to be finished out. SK looking to force a three-way tie to keep themselves alive. Guys, are you ready for this game in the audience?
All right, guys. Be sure to get to your teams. Get behind them. If you would like to see SK Gaming take a final win on their day here in Group A, let's hear it for SK Gaming.
Want to see Invictus close it out and take second place in their group 2-1? Let me hear you for Invictus.
All right, guys, and we are jumping into the match now. Your red team is going to be SK. Blue team, Invictus Gaming, These teams have pretty considerable level one team fights here. They definitely have good crowd control, but that Shenton and Leona is going to be scarier on Invictus' side, so we can see the cautious play coming from SK.
Now, last second swap actually came in from Invictus, then PDD to the top lane on Malphite and Illusion into the jungle on Shen. Just the same as before, though, that jungle Shen is going to come out with a wealth of crowd control, much like RNA as Udyr. So you're going to honestly see quite a bit of jungle pressure. The one advantage that SK has, which is actually pretty important, is that Udyr is a much, much faster jungle clearer than Shen. And so you should expect to see him level up faster and put pressure on the lanes more frequently because he can clear his jungle and get to a friend much more often. However, once Illusion finally hits level 6, that's going to flip on its head. He's not going to have the jungle clear speed, but he will have Stand United. He will be able to assist his teammates much more frequently on the map.
Oh, coming out, Xiao Xiao is going to see this. I don't think they're going to take him out. Nobody's really paying attention to him, actually. He puts a ward right next to him as they take a Polaroid of this, and it looks like he may be able to make it out alive. Sleeping on the job. SK could have missed the first blood there.
Now, overall, they put down a lot of pressure. They forced the Ignite and a Flash away, so the Summoner Spell advantage now actually here for SK. This bottom lane just got a little bit easier for him.
That is going to help. That HP being down, the aggression is on. A little bit of help here, BDD, as he mobilizes himself around, actually getting the experience in the jungle as they start bottom, so he's taking everything from Wolves to Blue and not just that blue buff.
Wow, Invictus with a nice move, though. They're actually setting up for a lot of aggression, giving PDD that blue buff for the start. We've seen that from a lot of these teams here. Xiao Xiao actually putting out an early pink ward in that tribe rush, denying vision from SK. This could be a level 2 gank from Shen.
Coming up, Shen going down through tribe bush. That early ward is theirs. They have one in the river. If they can push this lane enough, he can come up through the forward brush, but they're going to see him now backing off. That Valkyrie should be on Corki. No, he's level 1. He may not have it, and he's forced to flash out to get the taunt down. The exhaust has already been thrown. The heal from Summoner comes out, and he gets himself out alive, preventing first blood.
Good flash, good Summoner heal. Yellowstar had his finger on the flash button, waiting for some kind of animation from Shen, but that animation was Vorpal Blade, not Shadow Dash, so we got kind of juked out there. Illusion landed that stun. If Kid had still had Flash up, or sorry, still had Ignite up, that Ignite would have overridden that Summoner heal and pretty much chunked down Yellowstar and might have guaranteed them first blood. It might have been worth diving for, but in the end, that actual level 1 engage really worked out for SK. They burned enough Summoners that Yellowstar was able to escape from that situation because he had actually saved all of his.
A really nice super early ward stops Aranea from having any fun top. And it looks like PDD, he's going to know though. PDD is just staying there farming slowly. Aranea returns to the jungle. We'll have to look for movement here from Cass in mid. I don't know if they're really going to want to throw them out of the lane right now and make this happen. But we do see Karthus is moving up for a little bit of help for them. This may turn into a 3v3 or 3v1.
And what they're doing here is actually having Jace shove that top lane really, really hard to set up an early push here onto PDD. They've got Karthus from the side, they've got Udyr from the side. Kevin is going to keep shoving as hard as he can. He'll have a big enough minion wave that they can take the turret and really just jockey for position here.
Zatai taking a very dangerous route, and he chooses to go back. There hasn't been any movement top, so he says, maybe I shouldn't chase. But this could be the demise of PDD here. With that blue buff, may be able to make it out here. He does have his cooldowns to grab some movement speed from Q, and he really plays that one well, just putting himself on the left side of the turret, so it actually denies movement from the team.
That was really, really nice overall. Tanked enough damage, able to dodge everything. Now, he did have to flash. Once Udyr finally initiated that fight, he said, okay, you've got turret aggro. You can't chase me. I'm going to buy a few seconds by flashing down. It only takes about a second and a half to walk the distance that it takes to flash, but that was all the time he needed to spend. Yellowstar, though, in a tricky situation, Illusion is waiting at the bottom.
Sitting on his own ward, that one has been taken out actually. Yes, that's a vision ward. Flashing and he just misses it! He's gonna get slowed down, but it does not look good here. The Ignite is on, Nip makes it out, and he gets first blood as it turns around onto Illusion. They will follow here. It looks like they continue to farm, rather.
That was really good vision by both of these players, actually. Yellowstar and Nif both really, he was going to take a lot of damage from that turret on the engage. He simply turned around on him, that last Ignite tick there to close the deal. And Yellowstar narrowly escaping that flash shadow dash. I mean, he really expected to hit that. That was honestly just an unfortunate mistake there from IG.
The Zenith just missing, forcing a little bit of mana out of Yellowstar, though. He's going to have to be careful as he gets to this turret. However, he is a bit tankier than that Ezreal. Running that defensive masteries.
Well, he's going to be still in a little bit of a circuit situation. He's getting pushed around just a bit. And, you know, the poke is still going to be here. Even though they've given Nif first blood, it wasn't giving Yellow Star first blood. Lizard buff on a Corki is going to be incredibly frustrating in a lane against. With Nunu, it's really less that way. He's melee range. It's harder to apply that buff. So it's really kind of a non-factor in most situations.
You can see Zitai getting harassed in mid. Very low on mana. Finds RNA coming down from the top side of the brush. But now they have a location on RNA. The jungler, again, Illusion using this to their advantage. And he says they probably won't expect this once more. I just won't have flash this time. Getting slowed down, Nif, maybe taken down this time. Second time's a charm for Invictus Gaming.
Nice gank there, and that is really the jungler spent, or not the jungler really, but actually the support, Xiaoxiao spending so much money to constantly vision ward that river and that lower jungle to make sure SK does not have vision on what they're trying to do here. And they are absolutely focusing that bottom lane, trying to get Kid farmed. Right now it's working, a 50 to 33 in minions.
Throw the flash down bottom lane. Yellowstar looks to be taken down, and the 3v1 is just too much for him. Pure aggression from Invictus right now. Freak, they're really starting to turn it on.
That's exactly what they've wanted to do from second one, is go for fighting all the time, every time, and constantly going for that kind of a battle. Kevin putting on some nice pressure to PDD. Right now, he needs to be the saving grace, and he's doing that. 47 to 28 in minions. You know, the unsuccessful tower dive still worth it overall because he is winning this lane. Very, very good for him. But the problem is, Kid is on his way to being a total, total menace. That minion advantage we talked about top lane, consider the exact reverse for that AD carry, and you've got a scary situation on both sides.
We'll see if PDD can push this one out. We have backing from Jace. We'll have to see what Kevin gets for himself. He does have the Dorans for a bit of sustain, and he only has 700 gold on him. Looks like he will go for a Vampire Acceptor to stay sustained in lane. This is not going to be an AP Malphite. We see him going for a regular build. Bottom lane is seeing a little bit of pressure. Looks like Leona trying to ward his Nif. Just playing mind games right now, staying in between himself and his AD carry. Just trying to absorb any damage that could come out. And once again, the vision ward is down. Illusion sets himself up for that 3v2 this time. It's going to be on Nif once again. Yellowstar is just going to Valkyrie out of this one. So usually you go for the AD carry, but they may just focus Nif.
And Nif's the only one without an escape right now. Yellowstar has heal, flash, and Valkyrie all up. Aura, oh, this is so good. This is the counter gank that SK really needs here. If they can bait this fight out, Aura is going to sneak into the brush, but he's going to get spotted by Xiaoxiao. It's not going to be a fight, but here comes Illusion.
They do go on to Nif. It could have been miscommunication. A lot of pings were going out saying Illusion was there, and he wanted to taunt so his team could get there. They realized the situation was not going to be advantageous. Everybody backs off. See him pushing the tower. Jace, pretty easy time farming at the turret, knowing the method to the madness to hit it. Looks like Udyr running back up top. Great wards right now from Invictus Gaming. Holding off that raid section, but right now we see Udyr and Arne waiting off in the distance as he turns around again. Going from each lane to each lane, finding unsuccessful ganks is not going to help.
This is not looking good for Asa either. They're taking a bit of harass there from Cassiopeia, but Shoth behind his turret, he is going to be safe here. Did save his flash as a result, so no really big deal. But now there's an interesting kind of twist of fate here. So Invictus has spent almost 400 gold on vision wards, clearing out the wards at bottom in order to kind of set up those ganks. And they were successful, of course. You're seeing a 400 gold lead and a 1-kill lead for Invictus as a result. Aura, however, invested in an Oracle's Elixir, which as long as he doesn't die, will actually pay dividends much more successfully as this game goes on. He's waiting in the bottom brush to try to start a counter gank here, or just try to bait in the opposition. You can see SK really, really trying to poke in on the Kid to get Leona to actually engage this fight.
It looks like a lot of the lanes have actually gone back before they're able to finish that gold generation item. Udyr coming through quite fast, and it's only going to be for a ward clear, but aggressive ward clearing with Bear Stance. You just got to love it.
Yeah, well, but they managed to blind the enemy team. That's super worthwhile. They're pinging out all the possible ward locations. Aura can get himself rich pretty quickly by just sweeping out wards right here. As long as he does that successfully, it's going to be really, really good for the team. Udyr right now is going to be a crazy big menace around the map if he can keep moving.
Zhao Zhao getting some hits down. True Shot Barrage goes out. So much damage on the Nif. He will for sure drop in this fight, but the Requiem coming down. IG still looks pretty good. They are going to contest on a few more shots, and we see as well the Vorpal Blade taking him out, taking that one away from Kit. But Yellow Star falls.
A 2-for-nothing despite Requiem, despite Aura being nearby. It was mostly that shield from Shen really saving the day, and that's exactly what it is. Illusion finally hit level 6, and just in time because that fight had just started there. That was a huge, huge, huge move.
Bottom lane will be pushed. We're going to see your first turret dropped here. The pings are onto RNA, and they say, yes, we can get him, but he runs just out of Zenith range. 4-1, 10 minutes and 30 seconds into this matchup. A pretty nice 2,000 gold lead in favor of Invictus Gaming in that first turret to regain map control. Dragon is just within their reaches, so there's more global gold and experience coming to them in just a short amount of time if they play it right.
Invictus is absolutely controlling this early game properly, even from second number one where they set up that vision ward gank at that bottom lane. It worked very, very, very well, and they're going to keep this pressure on. Now, SK has a counterattack opportunity. Usually it's when you kill an enemy champion you go something like Dragon, but in this case, they know all bottom lane had to recall back, and they are off the map. SK, a very, very good call to know that even though they're down in this map, they've got the control for at least those 15 seconds they need to kill Dragon. That's the kind of moves they need to make. SK are very, very smart players. There's a lot of experience on that team. They've been pretty much everywhere and seen it all. These guys have played at the top level for just so long that they know things like this. They're going to try to accrue these little advantages to get themselves back into the game. Ultimately, they are really far from out here, and they've got such amazing late game. Again, it's a burst combo from ING, but eventually that will fall off as Guardian Angels are completed. The very end game for SK is absolutely better here.
So going into this one, without wanting to really break the crowd control the team brings, we see Malphite picking up Sorc boots. What's the point in this on an AD Malphite?
So what Malphite's really trying to go for here is playing as a diver. He's not trying to be a main tank. That's actually Shen and Leona's job. His goal is really to play like he's a Akali and just dive in onto the back line, stun someone as a result, and just throw out damage. Malphite's base damages are high enough that if you actually just run magic penetration instead of like ability power, you actually get more damage on squishy targets. And his goal, again, is to kill Yellowstar over and over, so he wants to do damage to a squishy target. Getting magic penetration, you might see a Haunting Geyser or Abyssal Scepter as the next really major pickup. And Abyssal is especially good when you're teamed up with a second ability power champion like Cassiopeia. That magic resist shred that you're putting out just by being nearby and having that item, it's also going to assist your teammate there. It's going to be a very, very good situation if EDD can keep getting farmed, can keep from getting ganked, and finish those really good magic damage items. You're going to see a very tough situation for Yellowstar.
D-Tai in mid up against Ocelot, 114 CS to 105. These two are keeping it quite close, and really neither of them in mid have seen any action yet. Nothing is happening. It's all about the top and the bottom lane right now. We're going to see what these guys have going as we check out some of the builds. No real core items being finished. Still very early in the game. We have had a Dragon go down in favor of SK, and they were just able to have the timer on that. That's big. It's a small step, as we said, but it's a step they need to take to get to the top of the stairs right now because Invictus Gaming is just hugely on the aggress.
Yeah, one of the best things about that overall was that it was snuck out of nowhere. Now, maybe Invictus kind of realized... There's no tell. Oh, look, the initiation in from Cassiopeia. Shen following as well.
Petrifying Gaze gets Ocelot right inside the turret range. They're a little too far out there. Great job. Requiem is coming down from that Death Defy, and they are going to be able to make it out quite easy. Quirky Nunu from the right side. And even though he was two turrets deep, Ocelot gets taken out.
Yeah, really, really nice job. We've seen this from Azubu Frost as well, but Illusion using the Shen ultimate just to dive onto a teammate and follow in from there. You know, walk up onto Leona, she landed a solar flare, and he's like, great, he's stunned. All right, let me land the Shadow Dash. Thanks to the taunt, easy kills picked up. Really, really good awareness there. This team making great calls, saying, yes, we can get Ocelot, even despite being behind a turret. Let's make this dive, we're tanky enough. We have the crowd control, let's pick up that kill. That's the kind of moves that Invictus needs to make. SK are going to get global objectives pretty well. They're going to have that Dragon timed. I would expect to see them even get the second one. Despite still being down in gold overall, I think they've still got what it takes to do things like that. But the difficulty, though, is IG, the ever-aggressive team, will continue to make moves like this, where they try to pick down enemy champions. They dive in. Again, they've got a great diving initiation combo here with Malphite, Leona, and Shen. We haven't even seen Malphite in these fights yet, but he's going to make this even worse.
The Illusion picking up his red buff right now. It does not look like that will go to Ezreal. He makes his way over there now. Kid is going to continue to farm that lane. The AD carries 108 to 93. We can see their CS or their minion kills are a lot lower. The focus on those lanes have really been about kills, ganks. We've seen counter ganks coming in and a lot of 3v1s, once on Nif and then once onto Yellowstar in the beginning of the game, where Invictus was able to take a bit of a lead. Looks like they're going to be donating this blue buff over to Cass. More than happy to carry that and refresh up. And a good push in middle here. They have quite the minion wave, and nothing coming up for Invictus, so this may be some good turret damage.
Yeah, they've got a bit of time to put some pressure on. That wall actually is really good. They get a lot of pressure on Illusion if they want it, but they don't quite follow up. They're afraid of that counter gank once more. Shosho, he's got the ultimate back. That Solar Flare on Leona, so very strong. Yellowstar's got to keep his fingers on the W button at all times in order to be able to Valkyrie out and away from these scary situations. Actually, being a French keyboard, it would be a Z, actually. So an Azurdi keyboard for the French players, but he's got to make sure he can press that button and Valkyrie out away. It's a scary situation. He's got to have perfect reflexes to react to this enemy team.
Oh, Freak, as I just mentioned, the 3v1 situation. PDD finds himself in just that top. You can see his team now transferring over. Leona and Shen right there. The ultimate goes in right under the turret. Yellowstar grabbed aggro. He will make it out alive with a sliver of health. And it won't be Leona quick enough to reinitiate once again and capitalize on a kill.
There we go. That Malphite initiation, so incredibly strong. There's a lot of great potential there. You saw it, it's the, you know, the follow-up from Shen. But thankfully for Yellowstar, he had 700 heal. He had the ability to Valkyrie out. He flashed away as well. Nip helping to slow that team down by channeling Absolute Zero. So the cooldowns are down for a short time. You know, there's no Malphite Unstoppable Force for another few seconds. But is that going to matter too much? There's still a lot of great potential over here. Leona still got her spells. Illusion's ultimate is just about to come up. That stand united on Shen going to turn fights around. They've actually picked out Nif a little bit. He might be in focus pretty soon.
We'll see what they have to do. RNA finding Illusion. Both junglers now with an Oracle. That will turn into a high priority target, but there will be a chase for that champion if it comes down to it. You want to get that off the map. You don't want them clearing your wards. Zitai coming in very fast, missing the Miasma, but catching a bit of the slow and grabbing one of his own as Karthus returns the medicine.
Yeah, this is going to be an interesting fight overall in this mid lane. The difficulty, though, is that Ocelot is very, very far behind. Now, he's got Exhaust, so he can do pretty well in a one-on-one trade. But anytime Ocelot aggresses, he has to worry about taking Petrifying Gaze to the face and dying as a result. Now, SK, they're getting these globals, though. They're picking up a turret right here. Yes, they've lost mid, they've lost bottom, but Kevin, Ara, and Nif have constantly run back to the top lane to try to get something out of the top lane. There is that second dragon as well.
1-1 on dragons.
No, 2-0. Illusion.
Invictus, rather, grabbing that one. Looks like they will be able to defend that bottom turret. They feel like they pressed on a little too much. Invictus Gaming as well. All these teams on that western side, very good at warning. Complete control of the maps. We've seen them grabbing oracles now as they play against other teams from around the world. We didn't see the first ones from Invictus and Azubu until about 28 minutes into the game. Now see them grabbing those a little bit earlier, understanding that map control, but still keeping that aggressive game that they come with.
Yeah, IG is going to keep really putting their boot farther and farther down on SK's neck right there. They've got them in a pretty good situation. It's a 4,000 gold lead. That's a pretty good margin for 18 minutes. Of course, they're up in kills. That's been the large portion of that gold income, but the minion kills are also really factoring in to this lead here. Now, again, those top laners have never really been in a major team fight. We don't quite know how it's going to fare out. Kevin, really more of a persistent damage source than PDD, although PDD, the great initiator.
Initiating in right there, and he gets caught under the turret. It looks like Shen will come in to help here, and he's just going to be there for an assist on his kill, and that's awesome from Illusion as well. It's like Soraka wishing during the fight on bottom. I just want an assist.
Exactly. It's just so strong over and over and over. These three champions will keep diving and find kills. And if they're able to kill Jace in a combo, you know they'll be able to kill Ocelot's Karthus or Yellowstar's Quirky in a combo. This makes it a very risky situation here where SK has to know that IG's dive comp will kill whatever they try to dive. What SK needs to do is either somehow be immune to that, which is impossible. They can't keep splitting up like this and getting picked off because it will keep happening. They've got to start a 5-on-5 pretty soon and somehow come ahead in doing so. The difficulty, though, is ING is getting a lot of pressure across on this map. They're pushing turrets all the time, and they're up 5,000 gold. So trying to fight a 5-on-5 when you're down this much money is very difficult, but it's what SK, you know, sadly enough, needs to do, because they will keep getting picked off, they will keep losing turrets, and that's a very scary thing to have happen when you're trying to push for the late game. You need some way to stop losing champions every 2 minutes whenever the ultimates are up. It's a way to slow that pace down and then get their gold income finally start going up.
We have 20 minutes in the match now. Teams really bolstering their items. The core item on Cassiopeia, nice Abyssal Scepter for her, is RNA giving a little bit of harassment to Xiao Xiao on Leona. see that Bloodthirster being finished as well as the quick Sheen pickup. So the Bloodthirster was finished and he bought a Sheen. So that's going to be a huge burst in damage that he gets from that, as well as if he continues the farm, he'll get even more damage per stack on his Bloodthirster. Rod of Ages on to Karthus. These teams are really getting into their full builds, and the potentials of the team are going to start coming out of their compositions.
And in these team compositions, I think Invictus Gaming just wants to keep going for pressure right now. And the good thing for them is that they have Shen. When you have Shen, you've always got the tools you need to put pressure on the map. They can split 4-1. He can push one side, maybe the top lane. They can send everyone else on the other side of the map. And they're going to force engagements and just let Shen teleport in and make those fights work really, really well. Now, in the near future, Standard United is still down and on cooldown, so they're not going to split push too heavily and engage too hard just yet. But once he gets level 11, which actually just happened now, that pace actually starts turning up. That cooldown gets shorter. He's able to split push faster and be in more and more of these scary situations.
He could get jumped on here, but he chooses to go up the lane, just leaving Yellow Star to farm on that. Kevin getting chased down here. Ground Slam does a good amount of damage, and he's not really even trading with PDD. He's just pumping through those potions. RNA on his left side, and PDD says, I haven't seen people for a while. I'm gonna be careful in this. But the wave is too close, and he wants it still. Illusion coming back down to the bottom lane, and this is that Oracle situation that I was talking about. He may run away, but they are going to super chase this. And there it is. The attack goes on. He taunts right into the wall. He couldn't get it to happen. They're going to lock him into absolute zero quite early, though. The kill coming down. He flashes over the wall. Great positioning by Illusion, but he finds himself in another 3v1 situation. Just back and forth from his team. Unstoppable force. Kevin finds himself in a 2v1. And they are just utilizing pressure all around the map. RNA, petrifying gaze to his backside, will only slow. The Miasma down as well. Another 3v1, and he's taken down. And Xiao Xiao would have just put the cherry on the top of that.
Nice moves by Invictus. RNA just getting caught out a little bit too much. Tried to support the team and was unable to. Really, really good opening setup here. Yellow Star just finishing his Trinity Force. That's going to be a power surge that they desperately, desperately need. Both these teams are without Oracles. This is actually a very good situation for SK because really Invictus is going to be in all sorts of corners of the map. They're going to be very, very spread out around. And so ward coverage becomes very, very important. They don't want to get those lost.
We see now that Shen, Stand United, being used to move and get mobile to Baron. That's another thing of having Shen on the map, or a global to quasi-global ultimate champion. You have a lot of movement and control over everything, especially with the amount of currents you have down. Yellow Star on the outside, getting locked up. They grab Baron, maybe here. Yes, they do grab Baron. That lockup from the Solar Flare was a little early, Freak. They really could have capitalized big.
I think they are ultimately just trying to waste time more so than turn Baron into like a 5v5 team fight where they would win. I think they're okay just taking the Baron advantage, healing back up, buying some new items. They're in fact all recalling right now. Now they might lose a turret for it, but you know, I'll kill Baron for a turret almost any day. And so, you know, in the end here, IG is still gonna have a good advantage. SK are still making the right moves though, right? They didn't lose any champions in the Baron attempt. They're counterattacking everything with turret kills, so they're lowering those losses as much as possible. But SK are still in this really, really scary situation. They are fighting for survival in this game. They're down 2-8 in kills. They're still relying on their map control to go for a dragon attempt. This will actually equalize all the gold that the Baron buff gave and most of the experience as well. The only difference now from that move is the fact that they are actually wearing these bright purple little tulips here that give them that Baron buff. That ability, power, and attack damage and the regeneration is going to mean a lot in a team fight. And again, SK has to worry about that burst combo. Will Yellow Star survive, or will they go for Kevin and knock him out? He does not have yet his Trinity Force. That's a very, very big deal. He needs to get some more gold to finish that up. Got Mercury Treads, though, instead. He's still very, very far from completing any major items. This is a very bad situation, though. SK does not have much of their builds completed.
You know, Yefreak, you just said the Triforce finished on Yellow Star, and it's going to help him to put out damage, but the 2, 0, and 4, and 200 minions of Kid is just so huge. Finishing just that Sheen earlier, he went ahead and just bought the Zeal, finished the Triforce, which isn't a huge amount of gold, but is still, for the amount of time that everything got into his inventory, is just way too much for the levels that SK is hitting right now. It's going to be a lot of burst damage. They don't have the levels of experience to stop. You can just see shredding right through the shield of Turtle Stance. Can't get another attack on. You can usually get 3 fangs out in that poison time, but he wasn't close enough.
Pressure is still going to be on. Cassiopeia, while she's really good at stopping pushes, also really good at aiding them. She can put down a lot of zone control. These abilities that say, hey, if you run through this, you're not going to like life very much. Please don't even try. And you can see she puts Miasma down, just spams Noxious Blast, and really keeps SK from initiating in. SK still needs to hold on for late game. Ocelot really needs Ravidin's Death Cap, but he's about 1,000 gold away from finishing that item. I don't know if they can last this long to build it.
It is going to be tough. They have minion waves pushing down every lane that is at least past the river. That definitely means they have the advantage. They are not giving SK time to focus on pushing these lanes either. They don't even really have an inhibitor turret yet, and they're dictating how this match is going.
An illusion now with his ultimate backup at Stand United. They will split in for a 4-1 split push here. They're going to get the pressure down. Ooh. The initiation misses from Malphite. Will they still fight here, though?
They are throwing back and forth quite a few of those long-range pokes. Mystic shots coming in, as well as missiles from Corki. And they choose to back off from this fight. Now, during that fight, they were able to take a turret and push off SK as 5 with illusion top. That's not what you want to see. SK really needs to regroup here, figure out how they can counteract that. Without him there, he's going to be there quickly, but if they can get the burst damage down into the right person, they'll be able to win that fight.
The difficulty, though, is IG really has both sides of the coin. They've got really, really great fight initiation. We've seen it over and over and over again. Malphite, Shen, and Leona start fights and they kill someone really, really fast. But at the same time, if they miss the initiation, if the fight doesn't start out very well, they've got really, really good defensive abilities just on that same side. You know, those same champions can really, use their crowd control for the forces of good instead of evil and keep their teams alive and, crowd control opponents. They've got their exhaust. All their flashes are up. Ezreal just innately is very, very defensive. He can kite backwards, blink over walls, be very, very safe. And, of course, the crown jewel of all that is going to be Cassiopeia. That petrifying gaze ultimate works best when they're coming at you. She's going to crowd control everyone and really make life difficult.
We have a lot of backing. Probably some purchases to go out here. Cassiopeia grabbing that Rabadon's. Looks like we're going for the Bloodthirster on Corki as well, unless he just gets that sustain from somewhere else, which I don't know. Won't believe he will. They don't have that sustain healer. It is Nunu. Bottom lane is getting poked out there. They said we can push this easily. It's still past that river. We can see Illusion still toying top. They got the triple split push going now. Nobody's really going to focus on mid, so they're going to try to draw them away from Illusion here.
And that's going to be really the case. They're just going to, meet up as for... I don't know if they're going to go for mid or bottom. Really, they're pretty much equal lanes. I think bottom makes a little bit more sense just because it's geographically split up a bit more from that top lane push. But they're going to kind of keep this train going. And maybe this time they'll actually land the Malphite ultimate and start that fight off right. But it's going to be kind of the same that same story once again, where SK is going to be stuck under their base, 9,000 gold down, trying to hold on to a battle. Their ward's getting swept out by the oracles from Xiao Shou. And it's just going to be a push once again for Invictus.
They are going to stay on that bottom lane. Shen's ultimate is up so they can get him whenever they need to. Putting some good damage onto the turret right now. It's about just above half health as they have the minion wave clear out of there. They have another one right behind them though, and all five members are honed on that bottom lane. Illusion's going to be able to do whatever he wants top. Nobody's even trying to stop him. So much damage onto Kevin, and the fight hasn't even started yet. He gets hit one last time. And it looks like they are pushed out of this one. They say, let's go hang out with Illusion. That inhibitor turret falls. They're looking to drop in super minions on this bottom lane. DDD standing on the outside. The wall goes down and the initiation could be here. A beautiful petrifying gaze. Ocelot trying to get back in with the file on here. He goes down. He is forced in that position. Chase will fall as well. And they start to melt in their own base. The fight really didn't even have Illusion there for the first hand of it, Freak. And the triple kill for Kid on Ezreal.
And now it's just Nip alive. And this is not looking very happy for SK Gaming. Their hopes might be dashed right here as they are pushing in for that Nexus.
The Nexus turret going down. They look for the second turret here. They don't have any minions though, and they're forced out. They miscommunicate, and they only have a sliver of health between Cassiopeia and Leona. That is definitely the right choice here.
Yeah, they are recalling back out right now. Nip making his way out of the base. GG well played, it's actually said in all chat, but it looks like they're happy to go back to base and regroup for one more attempt later on. We were a bit worried about that comeback attempt as they were coming back up. They didn't quite have the damage they needed. Would have been a bit risky. Xiaoshou getting pushed out. Nip kind of going to push in right here. That Oracle's going to actually fall as a result. Trying to get the damage, but here comes Kid out of nowhere. Nip getting baited out. We'll pick up the kill, but this could be a trade.
And he does take him down. Udyr, RNA knows Ezreal is the kite man. And it looks like he's good. Could get dunked on here. Kevin is going in strong for it. He doesn't have any mana left, but he's got the blue buff. They dodge the Cruise Shot Mirage and take him down. He has 18 HP.
my gosh, SK keeping the shambles of their base actually alive. They've got one turret still on their Nexus. They've only lost one inhibitor. All this is sorry, good game, well played. The surrender does go out. Okay, I was gonna say, like, you don't say GG and then keep playing. That seems a little weird. So SK making it as far as they could, but it's Invictus with the win right here.